devil is fast turning our father of learning into a national nightmare. What with pulsism, drama practices, and immorality gone on rampage. In a bid to rise up to the challenge of redeeming this castle of ground from his hands, a Christian Student Congress was held for Christian and tertiary institutions across Nigeria. See, now that you are young, date 18th to 22nd August 2004. Thank you. This House 10, Boko, Benue State, Nigeria. Let us sit back and listen as the Spirit of God brings us the message.
Thank you, Father. As we have come into your presence, we're in for a definite encounter with you. You will do us good, Father. You will set our feet on the path of victory in the name of Jesus Christ. Every load that has followed us before now, that is not supposed to be part of our journey in life, we shall carry it here in the name of Jesus Christ. For the sons and the daughters that God has given to me, they are for signs and for wonders. We are for signs and for wonders in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father. Hallelujah. Amen. Please be seated now. Hallelujah. I would like to thank the Lord for bringing you to this Congress. And we want to give God all the praise, particularly for the way He has led us from various campuses and different places to be here. It is a great privilege to be young. I want to know that it's a great privilege to be young. Those that are old, they envy the youth. Do you know that you are the envy of some people? Do you know that? They wish they could be young. Unfortunately, it comes once in a lifetime. No one can be young more than once. Do you know that? No one can be young more than once. You cannot be sleeping more than once. Do you know that? That once you pass the age of sin, can you ever be sleeping again? Is the prime time, the prime of anyone's life. So I like to congratulate you that you are in the prime of your years. You let someone say, look, you are in the prime of your years. Yes. Some old men, we have missed them. Hallelujah. Yes. Because the time of the youth is the prime of anyone's life, it is also the period of choices. Choices create indelible mark on one's life and destiny. In the course of this meeting, we will be talking about choices. We'll be talking about several choices that, and this is time to make them. Choices that will mark your life out all through your destiny. Some people don't know that what you see in some old men today that you don't like, do you know it was the choice they made? when you were young. Do you know that? If you see any woman who's married a satan and is being pushed to say one man, another man, another man, let me ask you a question. When did she make her choice? When she was young. The unfortunate thing about these choices is that their choices have become irreversible. The time of the youth is not only time of choices, it is the time for foundation laying in every aspect of life. The foundation for your career in life, you are laying it now. Do you know that you are laying it now? Right? The foundation for your marriage, this is the time you are laying it. The foundation for your future destiny, you are already putting a block. But in fact, everything you will become in life is being founded now in the time of your youth. And the time of your youth is also a time of warfare. I will be talking about the warfare of the youth, particularly tonight. I think we should start from that. The battle for the young. It is either God or Satan. If you overcome this battle now, as you are young, you will always and ever overcome with every sphere of your life. It is also a time of tremendous strength and energy. The time of the youth, the time of freshness. It is a time all your nerves are seeking the strongest expression. Where you plow it now determines your destination in the years ahead. Now, as you are young, is the burden God will have you take time to consider personally in this Congress. This Congress is not only because we just want to call meetings, it's because the Holy Spirit spoke very strongly that this time that you are young is a very, very crucial and critical time for the rest of your own life and of the days ahead of you. And we saw truth that is raging. Because I will tell you, both God and Satan equally believe in the young man. Are you hearing me? Both God and the devil. What did I say? They equally believe in the young man, in the young woman. If you get into the heart of the devil today, the greatest mobilization he is making is to the young person. And if you are able to get to heaven, and you are able to look into the very heart of God, it will surprise you that God is tremendously yearning for the young person. God says, happy is the man that hath them there in his quiver. He will not be ashamed to stand against his enemy at the gate. When that scripture says, happy is the man, I tried to read that scripture again. He did not say, happy is the God. To tell you that any man, whether God or the devil, is happy if his quiver is full of the young people. And when you understand the pattern, then you will understand why you are facing all the conflict that you are facing. You will understand why you are confronted with all the challenges that is coming in your way. You are at a serious junction of choice in life. And you dare not throw in the towel without a definite divine guidance. We are trusting that God will use this Congress to bring you as the first priority into a personal, fresh encounter with God, so that you can hardly speak clearly to you on what you must do with your youth in preparation for the years ahead of you. Today, I did not choose it today. Are you hearing me? The wife I have today, I did not choose her today. Where I have come to reach in life today, it was not today that I made that choice. Whatsoever your destiny will unveil tomorrow cannot in any way be different from the choices you will be making now that you are young. I want to urge you to set down an eagerness, a serious determination to break forth into the supernatural and to put your tent there henceforth. So tonight, as we start, I want to look at the battle for the young. And for our text, in a short way, I want you to look at 1 John chapter 2. I may be speaking about this several times because of this Congress, as the Spirit will be leading us. But 1 John chapter 2, and I will read from verse 12. I will stop it in verse 14. I write to you, little children, because your sins are forgiven for his name's sake. I write to you, fathers, because you have known him who is from the beginning. I write to you, young men, because you have overcome the wicked one. I write to you, little children, because you have known the Father. I have written to you, fathers, because you have known him who is from the beginning. I have written to you, young men, because you are strong, and the word of God abides in you, and you have become the wicked one. Each time I have stumbled at this passage, it always baffles me, what is this repetition all about? It always baffles me, I'm asking, what is it talking about? But in recent times, I have been brought to see, and this is one of the very serious reasons why my heart has hung again to the young people. I found that God recognizes three segments in our lives. There are three segments in every man's life. And each of the three segments are peculiar. Each of the three segments are very, very definite, and they are different from one another. And because people don't understand the peculiarity and the differences of these three segments, they are baffled at the challenges that have come to them. And that's why, because there is a segment when God himself knows you to be the little children. Do you know that when you are the little children, toddlers, you are carried anywhere you went, am I correct? You are taken to church. You are taken to fellowship. As they were singing, you were taught songs and you sang it. Little children. And if we will only be little children for life, we will have stopped at that and say, because your sins are forgiven you for his name's sake. And for several of you, when you are little children, there were not so much conflict in your heart. Am I right? What you were told, you believed it. There were no questions in your mind. When dad said to you, it is like this, what did you do? You believed it. And you went about telling everybody you met, it is like this. You say, why? He said, because my dad told me that. And even parents don't understand that after that segment, there's another segment. That segment of being little children, as good as it is a very, very simple, basic, short segment. If there will remain, there will have been very simple issues here. Then you will notice that was what challenged me in the scriptures. I thought when he said, I write to you little children because your sins are forgiven you for them's sake, this person should have written to have been the young man, have you? But did you notice in your book that he skipped it? Did he skip it? And then he went and said, I write to you fathers. Because you have known him who is from the beginning. It was same, but what did he do, the young man? I discovered that, again, it does not take much effort when you become fathers. All of you sitting, are you hearing me? Whether you repent or not, you hear me well. When you become fathers, there are certain things that will lead you by force. You will have no interest in them. Even when you don't want to leave it, it will leave you. Do you know that it's only when you are a young person that you can wear high heel shoes and you can be like this? Look at any of your parents who are fathers and grandparents. Did you see them wear such a thing? Answer me, please. Do you know why? even their legs cannot carry horses. Their excitement is finished. Everything is finished. There are many fathers today that they drank when they were young and they spoiled their pancreas. Now, when you bring drink to them, it's not that they have repented, but when they take just a cup, the stomach is already like, have you noticed that? He said, I don't know this again. I said, but you just drank a cup. The stomach is full. The reason is because whosoever won the blue over their lives when they were young have finished what he wanted to collect and he has left. There are so many people you see on the road now that they are abandoned. Do you know why? The enemy has already collected what he wanted and he did not want this empty carcass again. If you will hear me well, even though the devil would like to see fathers go to hell, but he is not fighting for them too much. As far as he is concerned, he has already collected what he wanted. You know, in 1985, I had gone to preach at a wedding. And I was preaching to this brother and his wife that went away, and the sister was the daughter of a university professor, and so there are so many professors and doctors and philosophers in the meeting. And when they invited me to come and preach, you can imagine how they were adjusting the goggles and saying, "Who is that?" And even when I said, "Let's stand up, let's sing," well, I heard them busy worrying us. You can say what you want and let him go and sit down. So when I noticed that their acting was that negative, I decided not to look at their face again, so that I can be able to hit them with the word of God. So I just said, "Stand up, everybody, right now. As we think, now when I started preaching, and the word of God started affecting them, I heard something. No, I said, You know, when you are preaching to old men and fathers, their response is different. The reason is that everything you are saying to them only reminds them of their past. They are not looking forward to anything. So when we finish this message, one man just walked up me. Two people walked up me. But the first one was this man. Who looked at me? He said, "Young man." I said, "Yes, sir." He said, "I wish I met you in 1943. Can you imagine? He said, "If I had met you 42 years ago, if I have heard what you are preaching now 42 years ago, I would not have been what I am today. What I do now? I have spoiled my life. I have wasted my marriage. I don't even know where to begin. I wish I met him. And I stood there looking at him, and he was saying yes. And I also was wishing I had met him. Do you know why? It's because no matter how powerful the message I preach, and no matter how he wished to repent, he had made irretrievable and irreversible choices that even repentance cannot restore. Then another woman who was, I think she was the wife of an academic professor in the university. She walked up to me. And she said, well, thank you for what you said. But for me, it's too late. But I'm going to buy the cassette for my daughter so that she will not go the way I went. Those things affected me a lot. I said, God. So they could hear the word of God too late. So they could even repent. When I say like that, that does not mean that they were too late to go to heaven. But they were too late to enjoy a right life. The word of God will have brought to them. So when he said, I write to you, Father, because you have known him who is from the beginning. You can notice that he used the word because you have known him. He's talking of his. When you face fathers, you talk about their past. Are you with me? When you face fathers, when you face elders, when you face those that are old, you can only remind them where they are coming from and whatever remains, if they can correct it and go and sleep. Even when the Holy Ghost comes on old men, what did the Bible say they will do? They will only dream dreams. And those of you that understand what dreams mean, dreams is a recapitulation of what happened to you that is being brought back to your subconscious. But it is only when the Holy Ghost comes on the youth that the Bible says they will do what? They see visions. It's very, very crucial now that you are young for something definite to happen to you. It is not a cosmetic thing at all. It is because this time you are is the most crucial of your lifetime. So he now went to address the young men. And I want you to know that when he was addressing the young men there, the word men is used in a generic sense. That is, it includes young men and young ladies. Is that all right? Okay. Now he says, I write to you, young men, because you have overcome the wicked one. When he came to dealing with young people, he talks about what? Battle. He talks about battle, battle for the young. When he was going to repeat it again, They have written to you, young men, because you are strong. And because the word of God abides in you, and you have overcome the wicked one. That immediately shows that someone is very, very, very greedy to tamper with your youth. Who is that person? The wicked one, the devil. And if I'm going to be showing you, which I will be after we meet again tomorrow, I would like you to know that this particular segment of your life is a time that you yourself you are surprised. I'll tell you, there are things that surprise you. And some of you are saying, why am I like this? Do you discover that as soon as you become a young person, the first thing that surprises you is that you query everything your father and your mother told you before? Have you noticed that? You are asking why. When you say a Christian should not do this, the first question in your mind is what? Why? A Christian must not go and say, and for what reason? What will happen if I go? Do you know what happens when you are little children? Your parents, when they went to the market, whatever they bought for you, how did you do it? Joyfully. How many of you sitting here now enjoy mommy going to the market and to buy you a dress? No. What are you saying? If you meant to buy something for me, you should have asked me. What do I want? Or you can give me that money and make my choice by myself. Am I correct? You discover that when mama just sewed one long dress for you like this, you felt like going back to the tailor to do what? To cut it the way you like. You see, you have reached the age where you must make your choice. Whatever anybody chose for you before, when you step into this second segment of your life, you have to reduce it. And that's why some of you are surprised that some of you were very serious choir member singing when you were children. And suddenly, two things fell out. And it's like something is happening for your decision, for your choice, and for your affection. That is the age. The battle for the young. But why is the wicked one focusing on this time of your life? I tell you three reasons. Number one, he has come to know that because this is the time of foundation laying, and he also knows, listen to what he knows, that if the foundation be destroyed, what can the righteous do? He knows. He knows that thousands of fasting and prayer cannot change a foundation that has been wrongly laid.
Are you with me at all?
So for that reason, he decided to position himself at this crucial point and said, because it's the foundation laying, I must allow this young man or this young lady to lay a correct foundation. Let's destroy it. Let's see what it will be after we destroy it. The rest of his life will be attached and will be a matter of struggle for the rest of his years. Because this is a time of foundation laying, the enemy wants to be part of your foundation. I want you to tell someone, say, go for it. The second thing he knows, he knows that there is certain things peculiar to you as a young person. This is the outbreak of all device that is embedded in you. Please, let me tell you, you know that what you look like when you are a baby, as wonderful as it is not permanent. But I want you to know that permanence, even of your physical feature, is only now. You are coming to sit down that whatever is formed with you is permanent. It's not likely to change again. Are you getting me? Even physically, your fear now is not likely to change again after him. So because the enemy knows that this is the time when permanence is established, he also desires to make a permanent damage. Are you with me at all? When I meet men that are disoriented in life, that have become addicted in life, go and find out from them. This is the segment when that permanence of addiction or disorientation takes. So the enemy says, when else is better to capture? Is it not when we can gain permanence? So because of that, if you are sensitive, the enemy is not happy at all if you are sick when you are young. If not. Are you with me? And the first thing the devil knows is that everything that will become your destiny is rooted in your youth. So he says, how else do I hope to affect this one's destiny? It is only now I shall affect it. And because of that, it is scrambling. That's why you are faced with all kinds of noises. That's why you are faced with all temptations. That's why you are faced with everything that is bothering your life. It's because you are precious. and God also, because of good men that is, and God also. He says, men we turn into a man's life, and he will be gaining the best of his life when he is young. Do you know there was a young man that was very, very wise? It was Solomon. It was wonderful to think of Solomon. When Solomon was a young man, and God blessed him on everything, and he had plenty, he began to make experiments when he was young. You know, he made experiments. He made many experiments. One of his experiments, he said, whatever my eyes see, I don't deny it. Anything I see, I buy. This is the age when you feel like buying anything you see. It's a clear age. This is the point at which you feel like expressing yourself in any direction. I met a young man years ago. He was in the University of Durham, several years ago. And he ran to my office, the thing God had said him. You know what he told me? He said that when I was 15, I decided I want to sleep with at least 200 different women before I will be with one. And he was serious. Very brilliant architectural board. But he fell out of most of that experiment was me. By the time I met him, he was just 18. But his life had been ruined. He told me, he said, I have been trying to repent, I don't know how. It's because I had to see girls. He said, in the girls' hotel on campus, when ladies have washed their undies and they put it on the rack, something is putting him to go and climb the wall and lick it. Why did the devil destroy this young man? The devil sees what he could have become. He said, let him shut. Why is God wanting to capture your life now that you are young? It's because if we miss it now, the possibility, you see, don't think that the possibility of you being converted is not possible. No, you will be converted. But your conversion cannot undo the permanence that your youth have already created. Why are we eager that we must not lose this battle now? Why are we praying that we must not lose this battle now? Why are we praying that you young men, you must overcome the wicked one now? Why? It is that even if you overcame later, the damage of the youth is irreversible, and old age normally bears the scars of it. It's terrible that you meet a man, a woman, very, very wonderful, you know, in her youth, she was pregnant for someone, somewhere, had a baby there, and had a baby for another. Now, at her age, where she's now set to go, and she's now moving with her husband, suddenly, the young man that she slept with many years ago and they had a baby turned up. I said, Cecilia, why is she calling her Cecilia? That was her name when she was young. Cecilia, we need to talk. So no, you say I'm married. Say yes, you know you are married. But we have a man. My son. This woman is converted. Are you hearing me? She's now born again. But when that man comes up and says, Cecilia, what is he calling for now? The mistake of our youth. Why must we win this battle now? It is because even if we win it later, the damage of this present time will forever be on you. Why must Jesus win the battle over my life and your life now? Is because any ground the enemy gained when you are young, he takes it. Even if you go away, he will keep that ground. And years to come, he will come and beat his hands on that little ground. But you cannot say you don't know about it. Tonight, when I see Jesus coming, the mighty warrior, standing against the wicked one over your head, I see Jesus with all his zeal and his power. He said, you wicked one, you cannot touch this one. This is a proper child. He's born for a vision. You cannot damage this one. But you see why Jesus is standing there and saying, you cannot, you cannot. The devil is saying, if he was attacked, you can choose for her. But she has come to the edge, the segment of choice. Let her tell us whom she will serve this day. And so can you imagine? The Lord Jesus, with all his power, standing. And the devil standing. And you are in the middle. And the Lord Jesus saying, oh, I'm here to save you, to forgive you, to keep you, to sustain you, to direct you, to make a choice for you. But the enemy says, you have come to the age of God. And so, whom do you choose? the unfortunate thing is that for so many young people, it was the enemy. Some said, let me try first. Some said, let me just try. And when they made that choice, I saw Jesus saying, hey, are you going with that man? He said, just for the time, I will come back. Jesus said, yes, you may come back. But you will not come back on that day. And the glance that this enemy gains today, he can't recover it. We used to go. That's the age where you are. When I was a youth hopper, I had a friend of mine, we were coming together. And he came to the Christian camp as a Christian. It was even our own zonal. And when we got to where we are to serve, he had to make a choice. Some people just came around and said, yes, they are welcoming coppers. And I said, I am a Christian. I have nothing to do with unbelievers. You know, immediately they say, you are swag, but you are confused. My friend stood in between. He said, Billy, let's do that. He will just go. When he gets there, there will be no problem. And I remember he took him to one beer parlor where he was welcoming up. And he ordered for I think, Coca-Cola. And this, he said, how could you, at this age, be drinking beer drink? And again, him. I feel like that. I said, even me, I will finish a bottle of beer. How much more a man like him? A friend told me that he was ashamed. And he told them to give him just a cup of good. What I'm telling you now is painful. That single cup of good took Stanley away. There was nothing that could bring Stanley back. It was terrible. He became so haggard in life. And I think he died. One day I went and I saw him and he looked at me. You know, he calls me, Brother Billy. He said, Billy, I envy you. I said, why? He said, we were together. And what you are today is what I could have been. But see where I am. I'm finished. I am finished. I cried. But I never made a choice. I even tried to repent again. But he has lost the ground. There's a ground before you tonight. Fresh ground. But it's contented. If you give in that ground, and I see Jesus standing here tonight. And with all his power, he said, look, get away from that girl. She is born for the glorious purpose. There's a future ahead of this young man. Don't tamper with it. And the enemy says, yes. Do you want him to be a robot? Give him chance to make his choice. Give him chance to make his choice. And the enemy says, what do you do? And I see him flashing all kinds of things. Flashing things. When we come to talk about choice of marriage, we're going to spend time on it. Because you need the guy to hear you. You will understand how several of my colleagues at our own age chose wrongly. They have not died. Do you hear me? They have not died. But they are in trouble. I had a roommate when we were on campus. You know, I did preaching. In those days, our prelim is what we call first year. And we were living in Gooding Block, in Far. And we were four in the room. And then we usually have squatters. So we have two squatters, so there were six. And early in the morning, when I knelt down to pray, I bed, and I looked down like this, reading my Bible. One of my roommates, he would just come and use his knee here and hit me on my buttocks. I said, this is not church, oh. This is not church. Only at the town. And he would hit me. And if he didn't hand up, then he would go and put on the pickle. You know, in those days, they gave this suit, they gave this suit, the big one. He would just put it there, and then it would just be booming. It would just be booming. Then I thought, I said, how are you doing this now? Get away from here! We will get you out of this room. I said, now, years after, many, many years after, I went with my wife to preach somewhere, and the congregation was that I could have. He was there. He said, when he saw the advertisement on the telly that one day I can is going to be, he said, could that be my roommate? Could that be my roommate? So out of curiosity, he came to the meeting. And you know, as I was sitting, standing up to me, my eyes just went straight to him. I just saw him. I almost called him out. Because I've not seen him for years. I started to call him, but I remember that I was in the middle of the day. So when I cooled myself, so when I finished reading, I was coming down from the pulpit. My eyes were in the air. I didn't want him to reach out. They said, no, sir, come here. I said, no, I have one of my classmates here and I need to see him. So I was walking through the building and he was also walking. When we met, I thought he was going to grab me and to delay with me. You know what he said? He said, delay. So this is what you plan to become. I remember when I used to hit your buttock. And he asked me, then can he have time to talk to me tomorrow? I said, yes, I'm eager for that. When we met, he took me to the restaurant. I said, this is my wife, Dr. Miss Akane. I said, hey. Then he couldn't hide you in that idea. Do you know? I wish I had listened to you when we were working D5 he remembered our room number. I wish I had listened to you. I thought I was wise. I thought I was chopping life. See me today. I am finished. But do you know, the girl I was running after that used to come to our room that time, she told me. I now have no wife, and I have no home anywhere. I can't sleep here, I can't sleep there. When he told the story, he said, Billy, what can you do for me? Listen, I offered him Jesus. I offered him salvation. He received Christ. He received the word of God. But when we finish, what will I do with my life? How do I handle the mess in which I am in? I have no answer for that. So you can't be young again. Especially you can't be young again. You are only a young man. This night, the battle for the young. But who determines the victory? It's you. As I say, you have overcome the dead one. You must make a choice tonight. Your choice to say no to the devil, no to sin, no to the flashy things, and to say yes to Jesus. That means the future. Maybe the battle is so strong on your life that you say yes today, and tomorrow you say, I'm coming again, and you're like this, and you're like this, and you're like this. That instability must stop here tonight in the name of Jesus. You know the unfortunate thing about the battle for the young is that the devil does not allow a young man to look ahead. Do you know that? What happens is that a young man always thinks that life ends at youth. So when you should have been taking a decision with your eyes on the future, the enemy say, don't worry about that. Just look right now. As I pray tonight, I really want to pray. As I'm seeing you sitting here tonight, something's happening and I say, oh God, this is a critical moment. If this brother or sister has made it right, then I know years to come, it will be right. I wish there would be some elders who can tell you their story. Who will say, look, I'm in the wrong place. And for 20 years, I'm still suffering it. But tonight, there's a fresh ground in front of you. It is not spoiled yet, but it is being untested. Whom do you miss? Whom do you say yes to? The friends that you have today, listen to me. They are not going to be with you. Are you with me? You will suddenly discover that the friend that leads you into trouble, to enter your trouble, he won't be your friend again. He won't. He will have gone on his own. The friend that lures you into sin today, once you enter your trouble, he will go. He will be part of the ridicule team. You see, look at that girl. is a job. That's what the normal say. Tonight, in the presence of God, and with the almighty power of Jesus, ready to save, ready to forgive, ready to reset your direction. But he couldn't do anything until you say yes to him and no to Satan. That's when you win the battle. That's when you win the battle. Now that you are young, as we pray together, as we call on the name of the Lord together, and I'm going to pray for you now. But maybe you are even starting to make mistakes. I want to tell you two things quickly. The mistake that you are making, is not a problem. The problem will be if you let it continue. What you have spent of your life presently is very small compared to what lies ahead of you. How will you use 5 to destroy 5 million? Is it reasonable? No. Whatever has been done till now, I wish you would be saying like I said years ago. I said, the time I have spent for the old man is enough. It is enough. I wish someone is telling the devil tonight and say, look, the past number of years I was dealing with you is enough. You are getting nothing more after that. Don't worry whether you will have power to overcome. All you need is to make a choice. The overcomer, the mighty captain of our salvation, is here. All that has stopped thee is that because you are the age of choice, you must make a choice. All that matters tonight is your own choice. The effectual working of the power of God to save and to keep you being saved is available of heaven. Who will make that choice? We are just coming to this meeting, but let's start it right. They say, tonight, Lord, I give no more inch of my ground to the devil. Shall we pray together?
You are able, abundantly able, to deliver and to save. You are able, abundantly able, to deliver those who trust in you. In the name of Jesus,
you are saying tonight, the ground that is ahead of me, I will not consider the devil. I'm not giving it to the life of sin. I have been in between for too long. And the enemy is looking at how to strike my foundation. So that no matter what happens now in the future, everything will have been spoiled. And you are saying, tonight, Lord Jesus, I have decided to choose to say no to sin, to say no to the devil. Listen, please. there must be a point when you are making up your mind. Several times, maybe you went for fellowship, raise your hand, and 5 minutes after, you saw your old friends and you went. Maybe before, when you come on campus, things look nice. During the holidays, things go haywire. Maybe questions upon questions in your heart has not allowed you to make a choice. And you must have to make it. Joshua said to them, if you this day, not tomorrow, today. It's possible that you have been in between. You have been falling and rising. You've been trying to be good on that side, but today you have been falling. Because your heart is not yet set. But tonight, the mighty warrior is ready to fight the enemy and say, touch him not, it's my own choice. It's my own chosen that I have prepared for him. Precious, don't spoil him for me. But the devil says, but how can you do this for him now? Let him be his son. As I see Jesus standing, I say, Tom, the choice is yours. The ball is in your court. Who is going to make a choice? I say, Lord, night. The ground that remains in front of me, I'm not going to offer it anymore to the prince of darkness. I'm not going to offer it anymore to the life of sin and immorality. I'm not going to offer it anymore unto the powers of this present age. I'm ready, Jesus. I'm ready tonight. My life has to take a new turn from tonight. Tonight. Yes. Where are you? You will not lose this battle over my life. You will not, oh God, lose this battle over my life. If you are coming, please move in quickly. Please move in quickly. We are praying. Indecision must come to an end. The devil must lose the battle. Say, I rise unto you, young man, because you have overcome the wicked one. Thank you, my father. Thank you, Jesus.